Okay, so we are a bit out of time, and what we are going to say is what already has been said. It's our experience, and I don't think it's much different from your experience. And it's about patients, about everyday patients, not elite athletes. We can say very few things about elite athletes. Elite athletes in Greece usually are operated elsewhere, in France, for example. Okay, so let me see if I can run with this. So we know that we are fighting that with something that is inherently unstable. The shoulder is stabilized dynamically, not statically. And what, as surgeons, we are trying to change the anatomy in order to change the function. And we are compromising between stability and mobility. And what we usually see is that we see a patient with an acute dislocation and has a Bankart or maybe a Hill-Sachs lesion, and then steadily he goes down the climax and becomes worse and worse with time. And back to 2007, we published the results of what we see after a dislocation, after what is we see in our patients who dislocate the shoulder or one or more times. And what was important, that most of the time there was a Bankart or an equivalent to a Bankart lesion, and also Hill-Sachs was very often. And what was important is that major lesions could occur from the first dislocation. Of course, they become worse with time, but even the first dislocation is not such a benign injury. And so what we did learn, what we learned during the last 20 years that we treat the instability. We have patients with some degree of constitutional laxity. They may be patients like the patients Dr. Morodeau showed in the morning, but usually it's some laxity, and then they have an accident, and after the accident, they develop an instability pattern depending on their level and type of activity. This is very important. And Pascal Boileau tried to quantitate these differences, and this is a very important score. It's well known. And that is what we take into consideration. The activity level, the number of dislocation, the shoulder laxity. This is a different patient, probably a patient that has to start with physiotherapy, bone defects, and of course, revision surgery. This is what we think when we are dealing with a new patient with an instability episode. And of course, the Bankart lesion is the essential lesion, but not the only lesion. And we can't treat only this. And what was the goal of the operation, of the soft tissue operations? To restore the labrum and to restore it with a lot of points of fixation so that to have a stronger fixation and to reestablish the appropriate tension of the anterior and posterior glenohumeral ligaments. And this is what we want to see at the end of the operation, a well-reformed bumper in the front of the joint, and this was what was satisfying for us. And during 2005-2010, we checked 33 patients with a mean follow-up. It was rather long, about 4 years. And they had some overhead and contact sports, some of them, half of them. Usually they were amateur athletes, most of them. And the mean age of the first location, rather young. And we had 3 patients, 7% recurrence rate. And this was very satisfying for this type of operation at that time. But the conclusion is that if you increase the follow-up, then the dislocations will increase also. And what we know now is that people continue to dislocate the shoulder 5, 10, even more than 10 years after the operation. So then it came all about the bone defects, and this is the classical article now. And what we say that even in rugby players in high contact sports, overhead sponsors, sport patients, you can have a very low recurrence rate if you do a good soft tissue operation, especially early after the dislocation, after the first dislocation. But if you have bone defects, then the recurrence rates grow unacceptably. And the defects are two, the Hill-Sachs defects and also the humeral side. And we developed it was developed the concept of engaging and non-engaging Hill Sachs. And although now we have better concept, still it's a very valid concept, because for us operating surgeons, arthroscopic surgeons, this is the best way to evaluate the severity of a Hill Sachs lesion. Small Hill Sachs lesions may engage, may be off track and engage. Large Hill Sachs lesions, most of them are engaging. And of course, Jim Wolf described the replissage technique, and Manos Bilakis showed our results with this technique. Pascal Boileau also published results, and this is our work. And I'm not going to repeat it. What is interesting is that even 8 years after the operation, for engaging Hill Sachs lesions with no peer appearance, the peer appearance of the glenoid, inverted peer appearance of the glenoid, still you can have very few dislocations. And then we start trying to measure the glenoid bone defects, and we have talked about them. And this probably, although it's not a quantitative, it's a qualitative approach. It's very familiar to all of us, and it's very easy to estimate. And what is the critical size? And the critical size goes slowly lower. And of course, it is the combination of these two bone lesions that is important. And this is what this Burkhardt and Giovanni Di Giacomo also tried to evaluate. So we start to using the Ed and Hibernet procedure from those two surgeons. And what we did is what Ettore described already. It was his technique that I learned from him and tried to do. The only difference is that we are doing it in a lateral decubitus position, and also that most of the times when we do a bone block procedure, we do a remplissage also, a remplissage procedure also. And it's well described. So we have now 4 years of experience. We have already 58 cases, and still now we have no recurrence after surgery in this group of patients. Of course, the follow-up is very short. It's 2 months to 4 years. Still, what is important is that we don't have a loss of motion still. It's a technically rather easy operation, and the functional result after it, it's very good. And this is something that makes us do it more. And now we try to combine this operation also with the ASA technique when, as it was described by Maiotti and Russo. And now we have, with a very short follow-up, we have 26 patients, and 18 of them was combined with a bone block procedure. And one of them is combined also with a remplissage. So what do we do? If we have bone loss, if we don't have bone loss, we try to restore the injury to the anterior glenoid labrum. We do an arthroscopic Bankart repair. If we have a voluntary capsule, if we have a big capsule, especially a posterior capsule that is large, we prefer to do an arthroscopic remplissage instead of reducing the volume of the posterior capsule from the glenoid side. I think it is much more effective to reduce it from the humeral side. And if we want to reinforce the anterior capsule, you can do, of course, Latarze and use the sling effect, but also arthroscopic subscapularis augmentation. The ASA technique is probably very effective also, and it's less invasive. And of course, we try to augment the glenoid bone surface. So why we go this way? Because we have less possible complications. What we are afraid is that not only the type of the number of complications, of course, Latarze procedures now have very few complications, and also they are manageable, but also the severity of those complications. This is what makes all these alternate techniques more we prefer them. So this is the patient that we operated last year. This is a very active patient. He is tennis, skiing, cycling, he does everything. He has returned to full activity, to full sports activity, and he's very satisfied. And this is the patient that was operated by Ettore Taverna last year. And we used a xenograft. It's the first patient that we used a xenograft. And you saw the CT scans of this. And we are also amazed about the incorporation of the graft and how well it works. The clinical results, but also the incorporation of the grafts, of the graft, of this graft. I think it's better than iliac graft. Okay. So using these concepts, since 2014, we have operated 244 patients. We have done 58 bone block procedures, and we did 78 Bankart procedures. This is what we do. 30% we still do just a Bankart procedure. 30% we do it Bankart procedure, we remplissage, and the other is a combination of bone block with remplissage and Bankart procedure. Of course, there are the other options. They have been already talked the previous speakers. And so this is how we started. This is how we go. And we hope to continue. And all of you are invited next year to see what happened with the patients we operated this year. And also in the special days of ESA in Madrid. Thank you for your attention.